Well, praise the Lord. A couple weeks ago, I taught on the subject that God wants you made whole. And last week we talked about good works. But the week before, when I talked about God wanting you made whole, someone came up to me after the service and said, well, what about whenever you pray and people don't get healed? And so I gave this person a couple answers, and the more I thought about it, I thought, well, you know, maybe I just need to teach on that subject. Why do some not get healed? So this morning I want to share with you seven reasons. There's more, but that's a good start, and I think I'll give you plenty to chew on this morning. I just want to say this up front. Don't take anything that is said accompanied with condemnation, because it's not what God wants. Take it as a challenge. Amen. And everything I want to share with you comes straight from the Word of God. And so we know it's true. But at the same time, I pray that the Word will be tempered with grace this morning. So be praying for me to have the wisdom to share in such a way that we can receive and digest the word properly. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now, I do have seven, so there's a good possibility this could be a two-parter. Well, and I have about, 20 verses of scripture back there. So we'll keep an eye on things, and if we don't get about halfway today, we'll finish it up. I'm going to try to wear you out, because I want you to be able to take hold of what's said today and really chew on it for a little while. Okay. Reason number one, why some people do not get healed is because they are not hearers of the word. In Romans 10:17, it says, so then, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Well, God, I pray that you give me more faith. It's not what the Bible says brings faith. Amen? We don't pray to God for more faith. He says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So if you want to increase your faith, what do you need to do? You need to hear the word of God, or I believe you can read the word of God, study the word of God. The important thing is getting the word of God down into your heart, down into your spirit. Because it says out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So if you have the word of God deposited in your heart, when a problem comes up, what is going to come out of your mouth? What's in your heart? Amen. And if your heart is full of the Word of God, the Word of God will come out with faith from your spirit, from your heart. Think about this for a moment. How much of the Word of God do you hear a day, or read, or whatever, study? How much of the Word of God do you hear each day? Now just think about that for a moment. Don't raise your hand, don't ask me, but think about it. Is it an hour? Is it a half hour? Is it 15 minutes? Is it 5 minutes? Is it 1 minute? Okay, now on top of that, think about this. How much of the Word of God do you hear a day on the subject of healing? I mean, how much thought do you give to the Word of God on the subject of healing in a day? How much in a week? How much in a month? How much in a year? I'm sure some could say maybe 60 minutes in a year. Or even I hear 24 hours of the word in a year. Faith comes by hearing. Well, is 24 hours in a year really that much? And church, the time to get ready for a storm is not in the middle of the storm. You prepare for the storm in advance. We need, the Bible tells us to meditate on the word day and night. But yet we think we can get by with coming to church and hearing me preach for a half an hour. Some of you wish, or 40 minutes or whatever, and maybe read your Bibles 5 minutes a day and think you're going to be full of faith whenever you get bad news. We need to prepare for the storm before the storm hits. So we need to be hearers of the Word. We need to read the Word. The Bible says study. In context to the Word of God, study to show yourselves approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed. Just because we're believers doesn't mean everything is automatically going to happen. We're told to study. Study takes work. I mean, you have to take time, you have to concentrate, you have to meditate to get the Word of God into your heart. Secondly, this is a very important point right here. Because they have heard wrong teaching about healing. Much of what you do here is it may not be God's will for you to be healed. Well, that creates doubt right away. Well, I don't even know if God wants me healed. How can I stand in faith and believe for healing when God may not want me healed? You may hear, well, He may be trying to teach you a lesson. You may hear, He may want you to suffer for reasons only He knows, or your sickness is for His glory. I just want to barf when I hear that. No, your healing's for His glory. He paid the price for your healing. Or you may hear, He cannot do anything because He doesn't do miracles anymore. The day of miracles is over. Or He doesn't heal today. He just leaves that up to science. Thank God for science, and God gave those men knowledge and abilities to help. Yes. But He didn't leave it all up to them. Why is it that most of us have little doubt when it comes to salvation? Because we've heard all of our lives, God's will is for you to be saved. We heard all of our lives, all you have to do is ask Him. You'll receive salvation. Heaven will be your home. And we have no doubt. We stand confidently and say, if you'll just say this prayer and believe it in your heart, you'll be saved. We believe that wholeheartedly. Because that is what we've been taught. We were not taught, well, it may not be God's will for you to be saved. We were not taught, your sin is for His glory. We were not taught, the day of salvation has passed. I mean, can you imagine if I stood here and gave an offer for you to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord? Let me just use Ron as an example. He's handy right here. Ron, would you like to receive Jesus Christ today? And Ron says, yes. Do you have a desire to be saved today?
Yes.
Well, praise God. I hope you are. I hope it's God's will that you be saved. But you know, the day of salvation may be over. You know, your sin, you know, might be for His glory. But we hope you get saved today. How many people do you think are going to get saved with that kind of attitude? But yet, when we turn it around with healing, that's what we do. Glory, do you have a desire to be healed? Yes, Pastor, I do have a desire to be healed. Well, it may not be God's will for you to be healed. But we'll pray. Who knows what God might do? You see, a lot of us don't want any kind of responsibility at all. That's why we just say, well, whatever God wants will be. You just never know. I might be healed, I might not be healed, but it's up to Him. No, He's already done His part 2,000 years ago. He paid the price for your sin. He paid the price for your sickness. By His stripes, we are what?
Healed.
We are healed. The devil's just trying to steal our health, amen?
That's right.
If we believe the way about salvation, the way many believe about healing, we would not see anybody hardly get saved. Because they'd have that doubt, well, maybe God doesn't want to save me. So another reason some are not getting healed is because of wrong teaching or lack of teaching on the subject. Number three, we're going right along, aren't we? Number three, it's okay, we've got a ways to go. Because they are doubters. Because they're doubters. Some are doubters. In Mark 11:23, listen to what it says. For surely I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, listen here it is, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Let that be an encouragement to you today. There's hope.
Amen.
And that's what I want you to understand today. is there's hope. There's been several times in my life that I needed to a healing desperately in my life. And, you know, I'm going to be honest with you. I didn't pray one time and it just happened. But I just kept standing on the promises of God. I just kept standing on the Word, standing on the Word. And over a matter of time, it was still a miracle because all of a sudden, just like that, I received the manifestation of my healing. But if I would have just said, oh, well, this is just the way it's going to be, I may have never been healed of what I was healed from. So my word to you this morning is don't give up. Yeah. Dive in further. Build up your faith stronger. Get people to come into agreement with you. Yeah. See, there's so many different factors that may be involved in you receiving your healing, but if you just sit back and do nothing, your chances are going way down. So, two things it says here in Mark. Remove doubt. How do we do that? Well, we talked about this the other day. There's two things we can do to remove doubt. One is to spend time with Jesus. They that know their God shall do great exploits. How do you get to know God? Two ways. One is to spend time with Him, and the other is to spend time in His Word. When you spend time with Him, you get to know Him. And when you know Him, you trust Him. And trust, church, is just another word for faith. If I trust Cheryl, I have faith in Cheryl. If I have faith in Cheryl, I have trust in Cheryl. We need to learn to trust God. We need to learn to trust His Word. And then, it may not have anything to do with your faith or believing, but those around you. He's well, I've been standing in faith. I know I've been believing. I have not doubted in my heart. But what's going on around you? What kind of atmosphere? You see, sometimes to receive your healing, there needs to be an atmosphere of faith. In Matthew 13:58, listen to what it says. This is Jesus talking. Now, He, Jesus, did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. Then again in Matthew 9:23-26, when Jesus came into the ruler's house and saw the flute players and the noisy crowd wailing, He said to them, make room, for the girl is not dead. Well, she was, but He's called those things to be not as though they are. Amen? Mm-hmm. But sleeping. And they ridiculed Him, but when the crowd, listen, was put outside, He went in and took her by the hand. And the girl arose, and the report of this went out into all the land. So we see that Jesus did not do many mighty works over in Matthew 13:58 because of their unbelief. And then in Matthew 13:58, we see that He removed doubt from the room. He removed the doubters from the room. And He got them out of the room, and there was just nothing left but faith. Amen. The crowd was put outside, and He went to work. You know, over 30 years of ministry, I've walked into many hospital rooms to pray for people. And many times, they would ask me to pray. Would you pray, Pastor? I'm glad to pray. So, you know, I lay my hands on their shoulder or something, and I just begin to pray. And I speak life in the name of Jesus. I just come against the enemy in the name of Jesus. And you know, I just speak healing to be manifested in the name of Jesus. And I mean, I just pour my heart out praying. And I'll turn around, they'll be making funeral arrangements. I mean, I think they should have called me to preach a funeral, not to pray for them. You see, that doesn't create an atmosphere of faith. And they're sitting around going, what kind of casket should we get for them? They're still alive! You know, wait until the breath is left before you start making arrangements. You see, because you've got to be in agreement. It says in Matthew 18:19, and again I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. You see, when I ask people to pray, I want them to be in agreement. Ron, many times when he asks for prayer, I want you to agree with me on this situation. You see, one could put 1,000 to flight, two could put 10,000 to flight. Amen. We talked about how sometimes, you know, God answers the prayer, or the prayer's already been answered, the healing's already provided, but sometimes there's a battle to get the manifestation of that healing. Did he or did he not pay the price for sin and for sickness? I'm careful not to ask just anybody to pray for me. You know, I rarely put it out on Facebook, you know, hey, pray, you know, if there was, of course, I've been fortunate, I haven't had any real issues in many years. The last time I had an issue, I believe God miraculously healed it, or I saw the manifestation of his healing power. I tell you, my doctor was more amazed than me, because she listened and saw, and there was, she said, you got a heart valve flapping in there, because it's like, and I wouldn't. To my cardiologist, and they took x-rays and everything. Of course, in the meantime, you all prayed. I don't know if you remember, that was a couple years, a few years back. And there's nothing there. Went back, she could not hear anything, and I haven't had that issue. I do not have that issue. Matter of fact, I had a real issue of tiredness. I tell Cheryl, I said the other day, I had to paint an apartment, and it just whipped me this time. And I said, you know, I don't get achy and all tired anymore unless I earned it.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, just, yeah, I'm 54 years old. I do get tired sometimes after doing a lot of physical work. But I earned it. It wasn't just because it happened. You see, I could have just gave up. I mean, I wish it was just overnight, but it doesn't always work that way.
Right.
Sometimes there's a battle to be fought. Just don't give up. You don't lose until you quit. I know Minnie Brown had some of you remember Minnie Brown, but she had a blind eye. She believed for healing, a manifestation all her life until she died. She never saw it on this side, but she saw it on the other side. Amen. But you know, my answer to that is she had a whole lot better chance of seeing that manifested by continuing to believe than giving up.
Yeah, yes, that's true.
And I can tell you personally, there's been many times. There's sometimes, you know, of course, doctors and medicine have helped, and I'm not against that, and God's not against that. But even while I'm taking my medicine, I'm still believing for divine health.
Yes.
But I don't just ask anybody to pray, because I know too well how many people pray. Besides that, most people, if you just put a general plea out there for prayer, they won't pray. They'll just start talking a bunch of doubt and unbelief. Uh-huh. Did you hear Pastor Tony's dying? Oh, it's bad. It's real bad. That's not what I want spoken over me if I'm fighting to see a manifestation of healing. If I'm in a hospital bed, I don't want you coming into my room and having pity on me. I want you to come into my hospital room and get in agreement with me and go to battle for me, amen?
Amen.
To see the manifestation of what God has done for me. I want you to encourage me not to give up if I get down. On many occasions, Jesus made the statement, let it be done unto you according to your faith. See, again, we don't like to hear that because, oh, we'll feel bad. Oh, you mean I'm not healed because I don't have enough faith? Maybe. Could be. It's a good place to start. Amen. Yeah. See, I don't get offended whenever I'm in that. I just say, you know what? I need to hear more of the word on this subject. I need to build my faith up. See, you might have great faith in finances and sick all the time. Or it might be the other way around. You're just healthy all the time, but man, finances are just pits. God's concerned about every area of your life, amen?
That's right.
Hallelujah. Let it be done unto you according to your faith. We can't get around the fact that faith is important. Now, we can go up to somebody whenever they're sick and say, oh, you poor thing, I really feel for you, and it's just so terrible that you're sick. And that might help come for a little bit. But in the long run, I'd rather somebody say, hey, let's just get in the Word here.
Yeah.
Come on, let's just agree together. Here, look what it says right here. Look what it says right here. That's a promise to you, Cheryl. Let's just get in agreement, believe for the manifestation of that verse to happen in your life. I'd much rather have that than, oh, you poor thing. Oh, maybe I'm different. I just don't really care for sympathy. I'd rather be encouraged. Okay, let's look at a few. Matthew, by your faith, be it done unto you according to your faith. Let's just look at a few verses. Matthew 9, 20 through 22. And suddenly a woman who had a flow of blood for 12 years came from behind and touched the hem of his garment. For she said to herself, if only I may touch his garment, I shall be made well. But Jesus turned around, and when he saw her, he said, be of good cheer, daughter. Your faith has made you well. And the woman was made well from that hour. You know, in another gospel, the same story, Jesus asked, who touched me? And the disciple says, what do you mean, who touched you? I mean, they were thronging against him. They were pressing in against him. I mean, everybody was touching him. I'd be like, whoa, wait, get back. Get in line. Just make a line right here. Okay, receive, receive, receive. But no, they're just all around them, just thronging in on them. But Jesus said, who touched me? And they said, everybody's touching you. Why were they touching him? Because every one of them had a desire to be healed. They heard about he was going around healing, and they all had a desire to be healed. But Jesus noticed one touch. Why did he notice that one touch? Because he felt virtue go out. She was believing, if I only touch him, I will be healed. Not just that I have a desire to be healed, but I have faith that I will be healed if I but touch the hem of his garment. And that's the kind of faith that we have to have. If I just touch Jesus, yeah, I'll be healed. He said, go your way. Your faith has made you well. In Mark chapter 2 and verse 5, listen to what it says there. When Jesus saw their what?
Faith.
He said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven you. Then he said, pick up your bed and go. And we're going to come back to Mark here in just a moment and talk about that one some more. But look at Luke 17, 19. And he said to him, arise, go your way. Your faith has made you well. Acts chapter 3, verse 16. And in his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you know, yes, the faith which comes through him has given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And you know, your faith is not your faith anyway. It's a gift of God, amen? God has given us the ability to believe. And James chapter 5, verses 14 through 16. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. I want you to notice how many times sin and sickness are in the same sentence. Because whenever you were saved, you were healed. He provided both for you on the cross. Amen?
Amen.
So these are just a few of the many scriptures that shows us the strong connection between faith and healing. Number four. Many do not realize the price for their healing has already been paid. Jesus took the stripes as your substitute, not as your example. He suffered that you might have life. The only suffering we are called to do is for being a witness for him, for proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's how we'll suffer for him. It's not talking about suffering in sickness and bunches of just trouble. No, it's talking about persecution. Look at the life of the apostles and the disciples. They suffered at the hands of men because they were proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ. And church, we act like that's not a reality today, but in other countries, it's just as real as it ever was. People are giving their lives to proclaim the gospel. Matthew 8, 17. It says that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, He himself took our infirmities and bore our sicknesses. He paid the price for our sin. He bore our sickness. When he did one, he did the other. If you're saved, you're healed. You see, we haven't been taught that. We don't keep that in our heart, in our minds. Let's take a look at Mark 2. I said we'd come back to this one. Verses 5 through 9. When Jesus saw their faith, and also says here, their faith. See, it's not always just your faith. That's why we need to get in agreement, amen? Sometimes it's too big of a battle for just me. That's why we need to get others involved with us. But not just anybody. Because you need to be in agreement. Find those who believe the Word of God. See, if you're praying and you get a couple other people praying, Lord, I just know it's your will for me to be healed. You paid the price. It's already been paid for. You know, in some area, in some ways, no, Jesus doesn't heal today. Because he did 2,000 years ago. You see, he's not going to save anybody today either. He saved them 2,000 years ago. We just need to come and receive what he's done for us. Amen?
Amen.
I hope you're getting this. Some of you, it's just a review. Some of it may be you haven't heard before. I just challenge you to go to the Word. Amen?
Amen.
Study to see if these things be so. Hallelujah. Where was I? Verse 6. Or we'll go back to verse 5. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, Son, your sins are forgiven you. I thought he needed healing. Why is he saying your sins are forgiven? And some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, Why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sin but God alone? But immediately, when Jesus perceived in the spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, Why do you reason about these things in your heart? Listen to what he says here. This is so cool. Which is easier to say to the paralytic, Your sins are forgiven you, or to say, Arise and take up your bed and walk? Which is easier? In other words, if you're saved, you're healed. Jesus paid the price for both. When we receive Christ as Savior, we receive him as our healer. That's one of his names, amen? God's names. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that healeth thee. Perhaps we should follow Jesus' example. And whenever we ask somebody to come up to receive Christ as their Lord and Savior, ask them to give up their sin, ask them to give up their sickness as well. Start them off right, amen? You got any sins you need to give Jesus? Well, of course you do. You got any sickness that you need to give Jesus? Well, give them to him. Number 5, moving right along. We just may make it. Many are not healed because they do not ask. Especially here in America. You know, we go straight to the doctor. We go straight to the hospital. We don't even pursue divine healing. I know David Hogan, we talked about him before, and some of you saw the videos, Faith to Raise the Dead. He said, where he lives and ministers in the jungles of Mexico, he said, either you believe God or you die. There is no St. Mary's or Deaconess down the street. And we thank God for St. Mary's and Deaconess. Or else Gloria wouldn't have a job, amen? But more than that, sometimes we do need that. But we don't. That should not be our first option. But yet, I tell you, the worse my insurance gets, the more I want my faith to be built up. You know, you go down and pay a $20 copay, you don't, I just go down to the doctor. But, you know, whenever you know it comes to $200 or $300, I think we'll believe God. We see there in Mexico where David Hogan is, there are no other choices. You see, in some third world countries, they have greater faith than we'd ever imagine having. Matter of fact, I told this story here a while back, but many years ago, a youth pastor went to, I think, somewhere in Africa, and there was this guy that was blind. And, you know, this Pentecostal youth pastor is praying for this guy. And they're all praying for him. This guy's eyes open. And he can see. He said, I was more shocked than they were. And I'm a Pentecostal preacher. You know, sometimes Pentecostal is just a name anymore. It used to be they really believed. Not coming against Pentecostals, but you know, let's just call it like it is. Just because you got a name above it doesn't mean you're living up to that. Hallelujah. Did I get through that? Yes. Which is easier to say? They have because they do not. They do not have because they do not ask. We need to learn to go to Him and remember what He did for us and receive what He paid the price for. Amen? Number six. Now here's one we'll have to probably spend a whole nother Sunday on. And we may. But many are not healed because they need deliverance first. I don't have time to go into that whole subject right now. But let me just share a verse of scripture. Luke 13:10-13. It reads, now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and behold, there was a woman who had a spirit of infirmity 18 years, and was bent over and could in no way raise herself up. But when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said to her, woman, you are loose from your infirmity. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. Sometimes the demonic has to be dealt with first before healing can occur. Jesus loosed her from the spirit of infirmity. Then it says, then he laid hands on her, and she was healed. You see, not all sickness is demonic. Well, it is, but it's not always a demon attached to it. But some, it is. And you have to get rid of that spirit, then pray for their healing. That's where the authority that Cheryl was talking about early comes in hand. As a matter of fact, let's just go there. There is a demonic oppression, and we have been given authority over every demon in Jesus' name. We do not have to be afraid of demons. And yes, demons are real. They are very real, but the power of God is real too. Amen. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I don't have to fear demons. I can't remember who it was. I think it was Smith Wigglesworth. I may be wrong. But he heard a, correct me if you know who it was. I think it was Smith Wigglesworth. Heard a noise down in the basement or downstairs. And he got up and he walked downstairs to see what was going on. He loved it. He goes, oh, it's just you, devil. You see, that's the kind of attitude we need to have. Amen. No fear. Only faith. Amen. You don't take it lightly, but realize who you are in Christ and the authority that you have in his name. In Mark 16:17-18, and these signs will follow those who believe. So if you believe, these signs will follow you. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents, and if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Dior, will you go back and get the snakes real quick?
Yeah.
No, it doesn't mean we need to pass snakes around in the church. But you know, if you reach down like Paul did into some firewood and a serpent bites you, you can have faith and believe and say, that's not going to harm me. You know, we're not to test God. You know, not say we're to pass around snakes in church. Hallelujah. Well, number seven. Some are not healed because they do not watch their mouth. In Proverbs 18:21, it reads there, death and life are in the power of the tongue. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. I challenged you here about a month ago to listen to what you said. Listen to the words that come out of your mouth. I believe as Christians we need to clean up our mouths, amen?
Amen.
And that goes beyond foul language. That goes to negative talking, gossiping, or whatever it is that's against the will of God to come out of our mouths. Death and life are in the power of tongue. There is great significance in what we say. If we go about talking about how sick we are all the time, and, oh, I'm just so sick, and I'm just never going to get better, that's not instilling any kind of faith in your heart, is it? Then everyone gets in agreement with you, and they begin to speak the same thing. Oh, they're so sick, they'll probably send them to their grave. We can't expect a manifestation of healing in our lives. A couple weeks ago, I talked about how angels heed the voice of God's word. And when we speak God's word, we are the voice of God's word. And angels heed the voice of God's word. It tells us in Hebrews that angels are ministering spirits to those that are to inherit salvation. That's you and me. Well, there's also a demonic side of that. There are demonic angels, demons, if you will. And they act on negative words the same way that God's angels act on His word. You see, one thing that people don't understand about the devil and demons. First of all, probably none of us have ever had an encounter with the devil. You see, let me just make this plain. The devil is not on the same level as God. The devil cannot be everywhere at the same time. The devil does not know everything. And the devil is not all-powerful. If you mess with anybody, it's one of his minions. It's demons. Followers of the devil. And they will act on your negative words. You see, another thing about demons and the devil, again, is they don't know everything. They know what you tell them. When you speak those words out, there's where we'll get them. I've said this, I preach this for years. Years and years and years. But I always love this example I give sometimes. And I'll pick on Tom this time. You see, there are demons that are called familiar spirits. And there are demons that are assigned to different people. So it's all in there. So that these demons that are assigned, you see, well, we can take authority and break their assignment, amen? You know? And we can just wreak all kinds of havoc in their order. But we don't really believe in them anyway, so they just do whatever they want to do. But they watch. They're called familiar because they're familiar with Tom. Like psychics and all that. Some of that's real. Because there are familiar spirits that are at work in those psychics, and they know what's going on because they've been around, they've been watching. Most of us fake, but some of us real. But Tom here, they've been watching him. He's standing on the word of God for a promise of God. He's standing, and they go, okay, look, here's where he's going to give up. We know Tom. We know how long he'll stand. Then he'll give up. So they're watching him, and then Tom comes to that point, he just gets right there, and then he just, this ain't going to work, so he just quits. What happens if Tom starts getting full of the Word of God? Energized by the Holy Ghost. And Tom starts going, and he comes to that certain point right there, and they're like, okay, guys, watch, this is where Tom gives up, and Tom takes another step. Well, wait a minute, he's supposed to give up. And he takes another step, and another step, and another step. Like, what's going on? We see, as Tom stands strong in that area, they will finally probably just give up in tempting him in that area.
That's true.
Then they'll just try to find some other area to attack him, amen?
Yeah.
So that's why we can fool them. We can take authority over them in Jesus' name. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. Then he goes on to say, choose life. Choose life. Don't choose to give in. Choose to stand. Amen. In Ephesians, it tells us, stand therefore. We stand until we see the manifestation of that which we are believing for. Don't give up.
Amen.
You never lose or you never fail until you stop trying. And again, church, this is 7. It's more exhaustive than that. I think that's enough to chew on for right now. I want to encourage you to apply the Word of God to your life. Don't be lazy. There's nothing more important than getting God's Word down in your heart. There's nothing more important than building up your trust in Jesus by spending time with Him. I know I made a renewed commitment to do just that. See, even as a pastor, I still got to make my choices, amen? I still got to keep on keeping on. I'm no different than you are. When I preach, I got to turn around and live it just like you do. It's not any easier for me than it is for you. But I believe it's worth it. Amen?
Amen.
It's worth it. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Hallelujah. Father, again, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the promises of your word, that they are yes and amen. And Lord, we're just careful to give you glory for all that you have done for us. And Lord, I pray that we would just open our hearts up. Lord, I pray that we would just have a perspective that, Lord, we would understand how important it is to just be in your word and meditate on your word and spend time with you, Lord, not as a religious exercise, but because we know that is where our relationship is developed at. And Lord, we want a strong fellowship with you. And Lord, I just ask that you would help us see every hindrance and take authority over it. And Lord God, that we would just move forward in your name. And we give you all the glory. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you.